Hey, welcome back. Once again, we're here in Indianapolis and it's time to play Stump Dano.
Oh boy.
And our host for today will be Jeff Schewe, and Jeff is going to try his darndest.
Okay, so I just want to settle this once and for all. Okay. What is the difference between PPI and DPI?
Well, PPI is pixels per inch, and DPI is dots per inch. A lot of people some people will use the word DPI when they're working on files, and there's no dots. Yeah. It's pixels.
Yeah.
And in general, dots per inch in inkjet printing are in the thousands, and pixels per inch are in the hundreds. And that's usually when people say, yeah, I did this at 360 DPI, it's like, I think we're talking PPI.
That's a decent answer.
Thanks.
But the next question is, should I resample my images to 360 or 720? With Epson, it is better to feed the print driver 360 or 720, depending on if you have finest detail on or off. And I've proven the fact that you get less artifacting. However, with Canon, it's 300, 600 PPI, not DPI, 300 PPI or 600 PPI. And you have the face that you want to argue about that?
In the early days of inkjet printing, it was felt that it was very important to understand the native resolution of the printer or the print head, and that everything should be sized to that in PPI, or even before that, when we were still working with 3-megapixel cameras, 6-megapixel cameras, you wanted to increase that in steps. I think it was called the Miranda something or other. It wasn't getting arrest.
Step interpolation.
Right. It wasn't an arrest thing. It was the Miranda, whatever it happened to be called.
Well, Fred Miranda came up with this, actually, Photoshop Action, which you would increase the resolution upsample in steps, and it actually produced a better result. And the engineer, Chris Cox at Adobe, didn't believe it. And actually, Photoshop got better interpolation as a result of Fred. Hmm. However, the bottom line is, I still think that what is reported to the operating system, there is a native resolution to the printer. Would you agree or disagree?
So I'm going to answer this question and then come to the much easier what you should do moving forward.
Okay.
If you're a purist and you're looking for the absolute finest quality and you have worked with the highest resolution camera and it's only on a tripod and there's absolutely in a vibration-free room and in every possible thing there is, then you will possibly see the benefit of being at the native resolution of the printer, which will vary depending on the printers that you have.
Yeah,
and will also vary by some of the settings. You're referencing a setting called finest detail that we'll talk about later. For the majority of us, and this includes many professionals, the technology has gotten so good that you don't have to be this crazy about it. And even Mac Holbert, who's been referenced, will be referenced, would say, as long as you're above 180 PPI, the majority of us are not gonna see that much difference in print quality. In all fairness, the way we had to learn all this stuff in the old days, 20 years ago, is that old, I guess, is these were really, really important because the technology wasn't there. The cameras weren't there, the workflow wasn't there. There was things, so you wanted to work at the highest possible setting. And if you're a person seeking that level of craft, that's all great. And working at the native resolution makes the most sense. But for the vast majority of prints, if you're above 180 PPI, you're gonna be fine.
So on another thing, when I do a nozzle check, why the hell can't I see the yellow ink nozzle?
The simple solution is just take your smartphone, hold the nozzle check up, take a quick snap with your other finger, and then just zoom in, and you'll see it.
Okay. So
you need a smartphone, but the assumption is most people.
Okay. The other thing I was going to ask is that there's this myth that you should shake, gently rock the ink cartridges before you load them. Is that true?
It's a good idea if it's a new installation or when you're installing a new cartridge.
Yeah, there's a little cartridge
to do a gentle agitation. You're not making a phosphate if you're from New York, or you're making some kind of, just a gentle thing, because these are pigment-based inks in solution. That's a good idea. If some people say, well, gee, I haven't used the printer in over a couple of years. What should I do?
Buy a new printer?
Well, first it's like, why'd you wait 2 years? But maybe then it would be a good idea to pull out those cartridges and give them a gentle shake.
Or could you just agitate the printer?
You have to be kind of a big muscular guy like you to pull that one off, especially like the one behind us here. But I'd like to watch that.
Yeah. Though I did have a question. There are people that think that if you print at a lower print resolution, you use less ink, and higher resolution uses more ink. Is that true or not?
No, false. So don't be concerned, oh gee, I want to print at the highest DPI because I'm going to be using more ink. It doesn't use any more ink. And it will take longer to print, which might be fine. And depending on your file and how it's managed, may help, may not help. When in doubt, go ahead and print at the highest DPI.
Okay, let me just ask you this. A lot of people look at their prints and look at the screen and they think the prints are too dark. Why is that?
The first thing I always ask is, tell me how you've calibrated your monitor. Half the time, what's that? For those that have calibrated their monitor, I ask what type of monitor, and then what was their candela setting, or their candelas per meter squared, or their nit setting.
Nit.
I got
a nit to pick with that. Go ahead.
And I would say another percentage would say, I don't know, I just ran it. The key to calibrating your monitor for printing is to keep the brightness of the monitor, which is measured in candelas per meter squared, sometimes abbreviated to candelas, and those that come from the television world, nits, at 100 to 120. Some would even say 80. In many cases, your prints aren't too dark, your monitor is too bright. It becomes more of a challenge with laptops, notebooks, because of the viewing angle. And then, of course, the other thing you have to keep in mind is the ambient conditions in your environment. So we always recommend calibrate your monitor, be it 100 to 120 candelas per meter squared. And be careful of being in an environment that's too bright, but also don't do like we used to do in the old days with transparencies, turn off all the lights in the room, Matt. You don't want to be in complete darkness, because then that gets you into that mismatch between the
You don't want to work in a cave, and you want to have an environment. There is actually an ISO standard for graphic viewing environment for displays, which I use to set my environment. So no direct light on, but I would quibble on the candelas. I actually run my displays at 160 because my white of my display and the white of my light box, I want to have that match. Your mileage may vary. But I think the important thing is to have a good viewing environment for your display and a good viewing environment for your print. And if you do, then you can actually...
And many calibration softwares also take an ambient reading as part of the making of the profile. So, after you've done the profile or prior, you put the sensor down and it reads the ambient light that you normally work in and builds that into the screen profile.
Calibrate your monitor. It's one of the least expensive things you can do to save a lot of time and a lot of money and not wasting ink.
And we will do a quick little episode on calibrating your monitor.
Somebody mentioned metamerism before. What is metamerism or metameric failure?
In the early days of inkjet printing, people noticed that their print would look fine in one ambient light condition. And sometimes just angling the print that would pick up a window, the color would shift.
Okay, so what he's talking about is Epson had a P2000 printer that if you printed out a black and white and you got the color to look great under daylight and you took it under tungsten, it looked magenta. If you got it good under tungsten and took it outside, it looked green or cyan.
I would say it wasn't necessarily an Epson thing, it's physics.
Yeah, well, I blame it on the P2000 because that was the first permanent ink So the bottom line is that is actually a metameric failure. Yeah. Metamerism is actually a good thing. It's the ability to match color under different spectral environments. So you want a green to be the same green under daylight and tungsten. That is metamerism. Metameric failure is the inability to have the color perception be the same under different lighting.
The three maladies that have, I wouldn't say they've been eliminated, but they're at a very low level, were metameric failure. The industry called it metamerism, where you'd get a color shift in different environments. Something called gloss differential, which was on higher gloss papers like a luster or a glossy, you'd get this kind of relief pattern, especially if you held it at a funny angle.
The ink reflectance and the paper surface reflectance were a little bit different, so you would see a ghosting.
Ghosting is actually something slightly different. And then another thing is bronzing. Where you would angle and you get this kind of funny metallic bronze kind of color.
You actually saw it. Yeah. You could see
it. Right. And the ghosting, that could actually be a form, if it was framed, of something called outgassing, one of my favorite topics.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so what is outgassing, Dano?
But I think the key thing is that these were all these things that we were dealing with early on. They're virtually non-existent now. You know, if you hold a print at an extreme angle, you're going to see that. But if you hold an old-fashioned darkroom print or a C print at an extreme angle, you're also going to see that. There's been tremendous advancements in screening algorithms and a bunch of other technical things where things such as bronzing are gone and things such as metameric failure are virtually gone. Now, outgassing.
That's not to be confused with gas passing.
And and the subject has come up. Just think of where I'm sandwiched between right at the moment. But with certain papers, and these would be what we call microporous papers. Some people might call them photographic papers.
Like luster.
Yeah, or an RC type paper. If a print is made and then immediately framed, there's still some residual gases that are going to come off of that print. And it may accumulate on the inside of the glass.
Kind of looks foggy almost.
Right. Now, it's easily remedied by opening up the frame and cleaning it, which, of course, is a pain. I see very, very little outgassing today. The key thing is, if you're planning to frame these things and you're using those kind of papers, don't do it immediately. Don't just put it in the frame. That's where you're going to run the risk.
A day or two, let it
sit out.
The other thing is
that I would even say an hour. And if you're framing without glass,
no problem. Yeah. It's kind of like, you know, if your car gets that smear on the windshield inside from, you know, like the vinyl and leather outgassing. I mean, it's like that kind of thing, isn't it?
Similar concept, but that's actually has to do with the air conditioning. I looked this up because I thought there was this connection, but it wasn't a good connection.
Oh, really? No kidding. All right, so we learned, we learned more Dano facts. He's the curious one, isn't he?
What is black ink switching? And why is it relevant to me?
Well, you keep referencing the old days. They weren't that long ago. But the early inkjet printing was on traditional kind of photographic papers that used the photo black ink. And matte papers were just kind of, the blacks just weren't very good and the colors were desaturated. So matte black ink was added to increase the Dmax of those types of papers, the cotton fiber, the fine art papers. And the way the head technology was then is the matte black ink, sometimes called MK, and the photo black ink called PK shared the same ink channel. So you had to physically either pull the cartridges out in the old days and swap them. As the technology got better, you could do it in the driver, but then the driver would have to purge the ink out of the line if it was PK, so they could then put MK, and that would take time and use a little bit of ink. And that was known as black ink switching. You may hear this term today because many printers are plumbed, so there's MK and PK, so they don't have to do that, but that's what the term means if it comes up, what's black ink switching?
And with the P900 and the new top of the line wide format printers like the P9570, which...
P700.
You don't have to, that's actually done. And then the upside is you've got a matte black plus violet, which I was happy to see, because it does expand the color gamut of the printer.
And we'll talk about gamut a little bit later. But even in terms like auto black switching, well, that was older generation where it would automatically do it for you, but it was still taking time and basically wasting a small amount of ink.
So what does high speed mean, and what is the finest detail setting on the Epson printer?
So high speed means that when the printhead is moving back and forth across the printer, it's printing in both directions. The technical term is bidirectional printing versus unidirectional printing. And if you're going to a big shops production house, so we're going to run that UNID, and you're going, what does that mean? So, and it used to be, referencing the old days, if you really want the best quality, turn high speed off, because that will allow the ink to dry and you're going to get a better result. For the overwhelming majority of papers and medias that are printing today, leave high speed on. There's a few that do require that longer dry time, and you turn that off for unidirectional printing. So it prints, comes back, and prints. Certain films, like a backlit film, would need that. Finest detail is something I wish it was named to something else, because it implies that, of course I want the finest detail, because I'm a photographer and I want all that shadow detail. It's really referencing the PPI in regards to text and type. So if you're working with PostScript files and text and type, that bumps it up to 720, and that's finest detail. If you're not using any text, unclick it, because it is not going to add to the quality of shadow detail or photographic detail. And it also takes a little bit longer in order for the printer to work on that detail and the computing horsepower it needs.
Dan, you're wrong. Dano, I've actually proven that the finest detail is actually useful for photographic paper if you're printing high resolution captures on glossy paper. If you have above 360 PPI on your native resolution of your capture, it's better to upsample to 720, then output sharpen and print, which I can do very easily in Lightroom. If the image is below 360, there's no benefit to upsample to 720. You should upsample to 360 PPI. And I can actually prove that there are things like you mentioned vector. When you have round things, you can get a better edge at 720 than 360. However, that is, okay, it's pixel peeping, as our friend Michael Reichman used to say. And if you want the best, then you have to do your best work.
So I think we're in violent agreement.
Okay, then, so when you're looking at the nozzles of the Epson printer, it does a little spurt, and it's the droplet is what is the size of that droplet, and what the hell is a picoliter?
Depending on the printer, let's take the P900 that we're going to be using here. It has the ability to print to 1.5 picoliters.
A picoliter is a unit of volume measurement, correct? And it is really, really effing small.
It
very
is
very tiny.
1/1,000,000,000th of a liter.
1/1,000,000,000,000.
But the more important thing, and this is, I'm the Epson guy, so, you know, this is Epson technology. It's amazing the technology in there to go to 1/1,000,000,000th to use 1.5 picoliters. But what makes a photographic printer, what makes an Epson print look photographic, is the variable droplet sizes, down to 1.5 picoliters, but also to 3, maybe up to 5 picoliters, because that's how you get those smooth tonal gradations. If you are using a technology that, say, use a thermal system that uses heat to change the viscosity of the ink to fire the ink out, and it leaves satelliting, and you have to use these screening algorithms
to
get that.
It's like a paint gun.
Right. Epson technology uses unbelievably small amounts of electricity in order to push the ink out into perfect round dots in variable droplet sizes. And we can go into a lot of detail about what that is, but at its core, the micropiezo technology, that's what makes an Epson print look photographic. And the ultimate goal with Epson technology is not to tout the technology itself and look at all these amazing things and at peak a liter is a trillionth of a liter. Isn't that amazing? It's all about all that technology getting out of the way so that you're not saying, oh, look at that dot placement. Look at that. You're just looking at the print.
Yeah, you're just seeing it.
So what about head strikes? What is a head strike?
Never heard of it. A head strike is when the print head is touching the paper in some way. If you're in a very dry environment, low relative humidity, and the paper is curling, that could cause the printer to cause a head strike. Head strikes are bad.
Yes.
But when you're setting the media settings in the driver or an Epson print layout or in Lightroom, you're changing what's known as the platen gap. That's the gap between the print head and the paper. Thicker papers need a larger gap. This is another one of those, oh, I don't want that gap. That's going to make my printer soft. You know, my prints are going to be out of focus. It's not how that works. So it could be in certain environments, you have to increase the platen gap. Or it could be your working environment, your relative humidity is way too low. And there's, you know, find a way to either raise the relative humidity or actually increase the relative humidity in smaller printers when they're being stored by using a musical instrument humidifier.
Oh, what?
They're about $15. It's called, for a company, there's a couple ones out there. Yeah. The one's called Dampit. They look like little green snakes that go into cellos and violins.
Yes.
And fill that with distilled water when the printer, you're not using the printer, put it inside the printer, and that will help keep the relative humidity.
Well, pretty much remember to take it out.
Two things, use distilled water and take it out before you print. Fair warning.
Well, what is the Kelvin temperature of the interior light of the P900?
So with the latest generation Epson printers, there's a light on that you can watch the progress of a print.
And you can turn that off,
which,
right?
You can turn it off, and it's really cool. But when people ask what the Kelvin temperature is, I tell them, you should turn it off if you have to ask that kind of a question, because it's not meant to be, oh, I can, my print's looking blue in there, but, you know, don't, what's the Kelvin temperature?
You're also looking through the darkened piece of glass.
It has two functions. One, that light lets you know, oh my gosh, I made a mistake. I loaded the wrong paper. I did something, and you can stop the print right away. The other function, I think, gets into our limbic system, you know, in prehistoric times. There's just something about watching it like a fireplace, you know?
It's pretty mesmerizing.
You know, it's like, I don't know. Those are the two features of the light inside the printer.
Did you learn anything? And I hope you learned a little bit, if not a lot. I mean, some of this stuff is questions that you hear a lot of talk about, but just kind of like, don't do anything with. Now you can talk a little wiser to your friends when they bring up these questions. So, Dano, thanks very much. Always a good discussion.
Was I stumped?
No, it's just really hard to stump you. But I would love to stump Jeff sometime. That would be hard, too.
I know how to do it.
Yeah. And don't forget, we've got the glossary of terms that you can look at as a PDF that also help you a lot with that. Once again, thanks for being part of the PXL family, and where we're working hard to enhance your vision, and we hope this helped just a little bit. Take care.